So we move on to the DBS.
All right, the easy part. Okay, this is the defined benefit supplement plan and the cash balance benefit program. So to determine the financial condition, we compare the fair value of assets, so basically no smoothing on the assets, with the actual obligation. And for the DBS and CBV programs, the actual obligation for inactive and active members is basically just their total account. And then for the retirees, that's the value of their benefits projected to be paid in the future. Compare those two, come up with the funded status. Add the actions that we always look at is consider additional earnings credit. Under the board policy, there would be none this year. So bottom line, both programs still have actual surpluses as of June 30th, 2016. All they've declined is shown there for the DBS from 114.5 to 111.6, and for CBV from 113.2 to 108.8. That decline was primarily due to investment returns less than assumed. And actually that was somewhat offset in that we credit, our crediting rate is less than our assumed return rate. So that caused it not to go down as much because the return was about 1% last year versus our assumption of about 7%. So generally you'd expect this to decline about 6%, but because our crediting is lesser assumed return, that decline was not as much. The other thing you'll note there is I did not mention the change in assumptions. The change in assumptions has a very minimal impact on CBB because almost everyone takes a lump sum contribution. On DBS, it has a little bit more of an impact, but still not much. Because remember, if we're assuming 7%, that's what we're assuming that's going to be credited in the future, whereas we used to assume 7.5%, but we assumed 7.5% was going to be credited, so those effectively offset. So the result is the new assumptions don't have a big impact on these two programs. So looking at additional earnings credits, just a reminder, a couple years ago, we went with our new policy on additional earnings credits that was adopted by the board. That basically was our first threshold, whether we can consider basically what we call filling up, where we fill up from what the rate that was actually credited to what the assumed return is the first threshold is the standard deviation on the portfolio. For that, for the DBS program, standard deviation is 15%, so our first threshold is if our funding ratio is over 115%, it was 111 and change, so therefore we were below our threshold, so no additional earnings crediting on the policy. Similarly for CBB, the threshold is 113% and we were about 109%, so no additional earnings credit. And I won't get into the second allocation since that does not apply. So looking at the actual obligation, you see for the DBS program, we have about $1.2 billion for retirees, whereas we only have about $5 million for CBB. As I said, most CBBs take the lump sum. DBS, you get much more taking the annuity option, as they're already getting an annuity from the DB program. So about $1.2 billion for DBS, that's about over 10% of that liability, the obligation. And then inactive and active members, $600 million at about $8 billion for the active members, which takes you a total obligation of $9.8 billion, compared to the fair value of assets of about $10.9 billion, which is a funded ratio of 111%. And on the CBB, you have about $236 million total actual obligation compared to $257 million in the assets for about 109% funded ratio. So looking ahead to next year, if you can meet or beat your assumed return, you should be close to, or at least you should be close to being able to grant additional earnings credits, but there's several other factors we'll play in that and we'll find out when we actually get the return. But just to kind of give you an idea of where you're at, if the investment return falls short of the assumed return, for example, if you have a true loss, not just an actual loss when you fall short of your return, but you actually have true investment loss where you fall short of your, you know, go negative on return, then you could eat up your whole surplus. But as long as you get a positive return, you would expect to still have at least some surplus next year. So in conclusion, current funding levels are still over 100%, although the board policy calls for no additional earnings credit because you're below the first threshold. So questions on DBS and CBB?
Sure. I'll move adoption of the proposed resolution on TRB 143.
And that's just the DBS, right?
Yes.
We have a motion? Okay, Sharon has seconded. Any further discussion? Questions? All in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed, nay. Any abstentions? Thank you very much. On to the CB.
MPP.
Oh, MPP.
So medical premium.
Just sorry. Wait before you go there. You need to also vote on the
CB
resolution. I thought we didn't do CB.
No, you just did the DBS. The CB is on page 183.
I'm trying to play speeder rules over there, Steve.
Madam Chair, I'll move adoption of the resolution on TRB 183 for the cash balance benefit program.
All right.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Moved by Harry, seconded by Steve. Any further discussion, questions? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. Any abstentions? All right, we've approved that also. Now on to the MPP.
Yes.
P.
Medical Premium Payment Program Valuation. So for this program, from the valuation perspective, we're just kind of monitoring the liabilities out there for the payments of the Part A and Part B premiums. As you see, there were actually quite a bit of changes since last time. And you remember last time is actually 2 years ago. We do this on the even years or the even valuation years. The SBMA is done on the odd valuation years. As you see, the results were $315 million is the actual obligation. If you remember that you don't have a dedicated fund where you have this money, but you allocate contributions in the future to pay for it. And where that's really going to play is when you come to GASB, because when you do GASB reporting, you're going to show basically no assets and you're going to show a significant liability. And I want to note on GASB is previously you reported the MPP program under GASB 43 effective with the fiscal year ended June 30, 2017. So coming forward, you are going to now report under GASB 73, which 75 under GASB 74 I don't think from the numbers aren't going to be a huge difference from GASB 43, but there are different reporting requirements. So the assumptions are similar to the DB program. The ones that really drive it are the demographic side is how long people are living. This has an even bigger impact on this program than it does on the DB program. And on the economic side, the net investment return, basically we assume 7% similar to the DB program. There are a couple assumptions that are specific to the MPP program. One is enrollment, how many people actually enroll in this program. You see the assumption is 2.5%. Now that's 2.5% of potentially eligible members, which are people who were hired April 1st, 1986 and earlier. So it's becoming a small and declining group. And then the second one is medical trend, which is basically inflation for medical costs, which tends to be higher than price inflation. And we've got a higher trend. Our trend is higher than inflation, you see there. So benefits, the eligibility is retirements on or before June 30th, 2012. So this only applies to people retired. You do have some people who are retired and not yet receiving benefits. For example, people who are 61, we don't know if they're gonna be eligible and join the MPP program, and that's why we have that assumption for it. Second big piece is the premiums. Part A is like 99% of liability. Part B has almost no liability left with it anymore. So the Part A is what's important. You see a small, for medical terms, a very modest increase of 407 to 413 over the two-year period, and you'll see that will have a positive impact. In other words, a lower actual obligation than we would have otherwise expected because we projected higher increases. And you can see that right here. Last year, we were about $342 million. You see about a $12 million decrease that we expected. That's because we're paying out significant amount of benefits and we're not getting any contributions. So we expect that to go down. Assumption changes, the mortality, as I said, has a pretty big impact. Combined with the return assumption, that would increase the actual obligation about $24 million. The other assumptions had a smaller change, medical inflation enrollment, and because the premium, as I said, was less than we projected, that caused a $19 million decrease. And lastly, everything else is about $15 million. And the DB program, when we have that other, we're usually really good about hitting it spot on. We're a little bit, we've been kind of trailing on this one, sort of in a good way, and we've had less people join the program. And this is generally because they're eligible for, you know, Medicare with their spouse or whatever the other provision is, we believe. So since less people have been enrolling, that's caused also a decrease. So that takes us down to about $315 million, which is the actual obligation as of June 30, 2016. Assets, as I said, really all you have is the Teachers Health Benefit Fund, which basically acts as a pass-through. You receive the contributions, pay out the benefits. So generally, you don't have more than 1 month of benefit payments in that. And as you can see right now, it's only about $10,000. So really, assets are not a significant issue here. On a funding perspective, yeah. It's 100% funding.
And that's through a policy that the board has adopted previously, that it's always going to be paid for out of future assessments to employers?
So let me interrupt. So when the program was created, it was, from a political perspective, created out of the assets, the surpluses of the DB program, which, believe it or not, back in 2000, we had surpluses. So it was created out of the surplus of the DB program. From an administrative perspective, instead of contributions going into the DB program, they go to this fund to pay the premium. So it's a way of using the surplus without going into the trust fund, which we cannot do legally, to just go in and grab money. So it was created out of the surplus of the DB program. This is the reason why we structured it.
Which we no longer have, though, correct?
We no longer have a surplus.
Yeah. But we're drawing monies from somewhere to pay for this.
But in theory, it was as if we had taken the money out then and put it into a separate fund to fund this. And so even though we now have a unfunded with the DB program, that's the way we treat this for actual funding purposes.
And Rick, didn't we do that originally because we weren't exactly sure how much money it was going to take us?
Right.
And so once we took it out, we would have had a pot of money, and we wouldn't have been able to spend it in any other manner.
Yeah,
so by funding it on a monthly basis, then we were able to capture that money if it didn't cost as much as we thought it was, which was a really good thing because we really overestimated how many people would be eligible for it.
So just so I'm clear, this is a pot of money as opposed to an annual outgo from, I mean, this sits as an actual amount of money that's there to pay for future benefits, I'm assuming.
So this is no extra money. This is a liability to the DB program. This is how much the DB program owes. So this is, on today's basis, if these numbers were precisely accurate, as of June 30th, 2016, if we could divert $314.9 million and put it into another fund, in contributions, this would pay for this.
To cover for future liabilities.
To cover for future payments, yes, liability to the MPP program.
Thank you for explaining it to me.
Okay.
Yeah, thanks, Rick. So, as I said, GASB 74 will be implemented, and I think Rick and Dave have an agenda item discussing assumptions, so I won't go into any more detail on that, except for the fact that we've already started testing it with CalSTRS staff, done a dry run, and we'll be working with them to get the implementation smoothly when it happens in a few months. So any additional questions on the MPP program?
I'll move it.
Second.
So it's been moved by Steve, seconded by Lynn. And this time it's actually me.
It is.
Any further questions or comments? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed nay. Any abstentions? And the motion passes.
All right, so I have a bonus since I knew you wouldn't be completely satiated with actuarial stuff at this point. Just wanted to give you a quick update on the supplemental benefits maintenance account. As you're aware, we don't do a detailed analysis this year, but given the change in investment return, change in the assumptions, each of them, three of them really will have a significant impact on the SBMA going forward. We did a quick projection just to kind of get a feel of what the impact might be next year. Just to go over those three changes, they are lower investment return assumption. Obviously, if the fund earns less, it's not going to be projected to last as long. Life expectancies have a bigger impact on this one because really you think about it, people are not receiving the purchasing power benefit until 15, 20 years down the road. So it's really only the people later in their life that are going to fall under this protection. So increasing life expectancies has a pretty significant impact. So those two will have a negative impact on our projections. The flip side of that is it's also very leveraged on inflation. Having a lower inflation assumption means it's going to be people are going to lose less of their purchasing power, so it'll be longer. So that will kind of offset the life expectancy. Looking at this, we found that really the investment return and the investment and the inflation assumption kind of pretty much offset each other. And then then you toss in the longer life expectancies. Shortened our projection, but we had a pretty good buffer, if you remember back last year, so we ate away some of that buffer, but we're still projecting, and we expect when we report to you next year, we'll still say the projections are sufficient to maintain that 85% purchasing power level. So, that
before we concludes, move on to that,
my report.
We used to talk about what year someone would retire that then they became eligible for the SBMA. And we haven't talked about that in those terms for quite a while, but I actually had a member ask me, what was the year that people are becoming eligible for the SBMA?
I will check to make sure the latest projections. I think we're around somebody retiring 1992 and before for certain are getting it. There may be some people at 1993 or 4, but certainly no
that's
later
held,
than that.
That's held early 1990s for quite a while now.
Right. Inflation has been, we get this 2% simple benefit improvement that buffers the SBMA because when inflation mm-hmm. is lower than that, the purchasing power actually improves. So basically we've had lower enough inflation that members have not been receiving, retiring after that, have not been eligible for SBMA.
Thank you, Rick. That's probably good enough. Thank you. All right.
Do you get to leave? I know David and Rick
don't. No, he doesn't get to leave either.
Okay, well, we're just going to keep on going.
He's going to have to stay beside us. Okay, item number 6.
Yes.
Quite a lot of items for you to approve here. We have 9 separate resolutions. The one thing I want to remind the board, in February when you adopted the new assumptions, if you recall, we had a discussion around member calculations. And the decision that the board took was to go to 7% immediately for all member-related calculations, service credit purchases, option factors, and so forth. So that decision has been reflected in this item. So if you, I'm not going to go into too much details because I think if, unless you have any questions, but I'm just going to point out the first item, which is we're asking you to adopt the regular interest rate. That is 7% because that's what we adopted. Items 2, 3, and 4 are simply linked to treasury rates as per board policies. So you, and you can see all the new rates on page 217. Items 5 and 6 are linked to the employer contribution rate. So they are going up in July because the employer contribution rates are scheduled to go up in July. I'm going to jump now to item 9, since it's in that table. We have something called a, when a member retires and has excess sick leave, the employer from which they retire are charged an amount based on the amount of sick leave that they have. This is a, an actuarial calculation, so we had to update it to reflect the longer life expectancies and the lower expected return. So the cost is increasing from about 0.3 to 0.33. And if you're trying to see what do these numbers mean, think of someone that has exactly 1 year of service from the excess sick leave. We used to charge them 30 cents for each dollar of salaries that they have at retirement. We're now going to charge them 33 cents for each year of service. That's excess sick leave. So that's, that will be effective July 1st of 17. The next one that has is being impacted by the change in assumption are the permissive service credit rates, which are listed on, you can start to see them on page 237, 238, and 39. You can look at them at your pleasure later. The big highlight here is because of the change in assumptions, most of the factors are increasing by a relative 10 to 20%. So the cost to purchase service starting July 1st will be increasing, again, as a result mostly of the assumption change. And we are reflecting 7% here. So that takes care of 7 or 8 of the 9 resolutions. The last one I want to talk about is...
Hang on,
yes, any questions on those?
And I don't know, that maybe not for you, Dave, but yeah. It might be for our... who am I looking at? I don't know. Someone. Not council. But just when we make these contributions, when we make these changes, I'm thinking, for example, when people buy, you know, service credit, how do we send out, how do the members, I know that we give a bill, like when a faculty or teacher wants to know how much it costs to purchase, you know, permissive service credit, I'm using the right term. They kind of give a bill and says this is how much it costs. But do members know and understand that those rates increase every year, and do we educate? Is that a grant question? I guess I'm sorry to go out of the actuarial world, but to Harry's point, these all kind of connect together to me, these conversations, right, in terms of how it impacts our members. How does that get communicated?
I think
grant?
We do that in a number of different ways. We have we'll communicate with the employers through employer directives, where we, and then we hope that that filters down to the teachers. We have online publications and newsletters for members, and then I'm certain there's ways that I don't understand because I haven't been here that long, but through member account services under Andrew's shop and benefits and services, they have ways that they reach out to employers, but. Robin, thank you.
So the calculators are also updated online.
Okay.
And that's probably the most informative method, because most people try out the cost of purchasing service before they actually even submit the application.
Yeah.
In general, service is more expensive than people expect. So we get applications more than we get purchases.
Right.
So when the rubber meets the road, it's really as the calculator is exercised in terms of testing the cost.
I hear counselors tell members, and I think I've told teachers this, I hope this is true, that, you know, sort of that it's cheaper the younger you are to purchase
yes.
it.
Yes.
But I also think this factor of, I mean, the board's taking action to approve increased costs, I mean, that's another factor. So I guess I was just kind of curious I know most members don't really track any of this. I guess I'm just curious as we raise.
Right, so that was a subject of conversation. I haven't seen a spike in applications, you know, since the February meeting.
Right, no. I was shocked when I got my, you know, I asked for, I think, back in the day with airtime, and I was shocked at how expensive it was, but it's worth it, really, you know, expensive. It's worth it if you had it. But anyway, thank you. Thanks, Grant, and thanks for the divergence, actuaries, but I just think that's how that translates to our members.
And could you explain excess sick leave?
Yeah, so based, I'll try to keep it a little bit simple because there are various rules, but think about, let's say every teacher gets a base amount of sick leave. I'm going to call it 12 days a year just to make it simpler. Or I think the way that the law reads, it's 1 day per pay period. So if they work 12 months a year, you can say your base is 12. If an employer provides 24, 12, then anything above one becomes excess. And it's supposed to get carried from one employer to the next, and it's the last employer that pays for it. So that's how it's done today.
And there are parameters within that, because if you don't work, when you go from an employer and it's within a certain time limit, you hit another employer, the new employer is responsible for it. But if there's a span of, I think it might be 2 years, might be a little bit shorter, then the next district doesn't have to accept any of that, and you lose it. So
I guess can I just,
yeah, ask, go ahead.
So, but unused excess sick leave, I mean, a lot of people have unused sick leave when they retire, and I know that translates to service credit. Is there something different with excess?
Yeah, I'll go into this. So if you look at the employer contribution rate today, we have a base employer rate of 8.25.
Right.
The 0.25% was added somewhere in the 80s, 90s?
86.
I knew Rick, you know, Amy this morning called me a fact checker from when I was at CalPERS. He's my fact checker
He's
over there.
Fact checker at
Anything I need to know, I just reach to the other office beside mine, and he has all the answers.
There you go.
So the 0.25 was meant to fund what we call just the regular unused sick leave.
Got it.
So that's the funding for that portion. There are no funding for excess. So the excess is charged. We charge the employer when it occurs.
So
if I get 10, if I get 10, but somehow through whatever, my employer gives me more, I get to use it, but they have to pay for it.
Okay. Yes.
I'm just kind of trying to think of scenarios where that, I guess that could happen. I don't.
I think it's more for maybe smaller classes of employees.
Okay. We'll leave it at that. Okay.
Alrighty. Go ahead, David.
Okay, so if there are no questions on these, I'm just going to talk about the item number 8 here, the lump sum debt benefit. We understand that this is a delicate subject with many of our stakeholders. Every year we perform an analysis of what it would cost if the board were to recommend changes to the lump sum debt benefit. We've looked on page 244 of your booklet. You can see the various cost impact of either, you know, increase it to full inflation, half of the inflation, so forth. We've got 4 scenarios here. Our recommendation right now is to keep the amount as is, mostly considering the report you just heard from Nick about the fact that our funding levels have dropped, that contribution rates are going to have to increase substantially over the next few years. Although these amounts may look small in comparison to the size of our portfolio, our recommendation is that at this point we leave them the same when you consider everything else that's happening with the funding of our system. So with this, if you have any other questions, we'll be happy to answer them. If not, we have 9 separate resolutions for you to adopt.
I'm hoping we don't do this 9 separate times. So pleasure of the board. We can do all the resolutions at one. All the rate increases are on, or all the rate changes are on 217. What is the pleasure of the board? Would you like to move them all as one? And if someone wants to talk about a specific, we can pull it. And then they can talk about it that way. We'll move on the ones that we're all in agreement on. And then we can go back to the one that's pulled. All right. So is there anyone?
Excuse me, Madam Chair, as a preliminary, I move that we waive verbatim reading of the 9 resolutions.
Okay.
I'm
we got that good.
Make a motion.
Okay. Sure.
Sharon.
In concurrence with my colleague Tom, I would move staff approval of those 9 items. Can we do them together in total?
Yes, that's what I was suggesting.
Yep.
Is there a second?
Second.
Alrighty. Harry, would you like to pull one?
No.
Alright, would you like to go ahead and make a comment?
No.
Okay. Alrighty. Are there any further comments? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
It's Brian.
Oh, Brian.
I'm sorry, could I add to your motion, at least read into the record the page numbers for the
Do you have the page numbers of the resolutions?
Yes.
Thank you.
Yes.
Absolutely.
So regular interest rate TRB 221, credited interest rate TRB 223, minimum interest rate cash balance benefit program 225, minimum interest rate DBS 227, employer contribution for elected officials of employee organizations 230, employer contribution rate for reduced workload program 233, permissive service contribution rates defined benefit program 241, lump sum death benefit for active and retired members 246, unused excess sick leave factor 248.
Thank you, Brian. We appreciate that. All right. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed say nay. Any abstentions? The motion passes. Thank you, gentlemen. All right.
Almost there.
Yep. Now we have
only 2 resolutions this time. GASB. So Nick alluded to this. This year we will be implementing for the first time GASB 74 in our 2007 financial statements. In 2014, and this is for the MPP program. In 2014, we implemented GASB 67 for our pension program. What we are asking with the change in assumption the board adopted in February, we wanted to update the resolution you updated back in 2014 for the DB program, DBSCB, and we have a new resolution for the MPP program. The main thing here is the valuation you saw for the defined benefit program, the 2016 valuation was at 7.25. We are moving directly to the long-term 7% assumption for all accounting calculations this year. So that's the one change we are doing to the defined benefit valuation, to the resolution for GASB 67. So we'll be using 7%. And on the MPP side, we are also recommending the use of 7, and consistent with what we have in GASB, in our resolution for GASB 67, we are also recommending the use of the 20-year government bond index that we are using for the DB program. On the DB side, because we now, with the funding plan, we expect to reach full funding, that index right now never comes into play. Basically, GASB has this rule that says you're supposed to do a projection of assets, and if you see your assets will be depleted, you're supposed to discount future benefit payments using this 20-year government bond index. This will come into play in our calculation for the MPP program because of the fact, you know, it's really on a, you could view it as a pay-as-you-go basis, the way it's funded. So we expect to be using, in reality, more of a investment return assumption, probably somewhere close to 4 when we do the MPP accounting calculations for GASB 74. So all of these changes are incorporated in the 2 resolutions in front of you that are up for adoption. I'll take any questions if you have some.
So, David, one of the things you just said confused me.
Okay.
So on GASB 74, in the resolution, it says 7%. But I thought you just said that we were going to
Here's what GASB says. So GASB says do a cash flow projection.
Okay.
And in the years in which you have assets in your fund, discount those at your expected investment return, which would be 7.
Okay.
And in years where you've run out of assets, use the government bond index. So we expect that we'll use 7% probably for a portion of the first year.
Okay.
Because we have very little assets, so that's why.
I understand that.
Okay.
All righty. Thank you very much. We have 2 resolutions. They are back-to-back. So one is on page 265, and the other is on 267. So page 265 is GASB 67, and on 266 is GASB 74. Without objection, we'll bundle those for a motion, and I'll entertain a motion. It's been moved by Tom, seconded by Paul. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed nay. Any abstentions? And that motion passes. We have one more to do with David and Rick. And Rick, are you still there with that? Or Nick, I'm sorry.
Till they boot me.
Yes, it will be quick.
Okay, so still all three of you, okay.
Good, and Robin is gonna say something after, on an unrelated topic, after I'm done with this.
Okay.
Item 8 is an information item, so there is nothing to adopt. Every couple of years, we have our work peer-reviewed, replicated by an independent actuarial firm. I just want you to understand also, so each year Milliman does the valuation. We are fully aware that they have good internal controls, that they have strong peer review process internally. On top of that, Rick and I, and now Jordan, we spend a fair amount of time every year going over the numbers that Milliman calculates their report to make sure, you know, that we're okay with them. Then these numbers go through further review when Crowe audits our financial statements. Not all of them, only the actual calculations that make their, you know, that make their way into our financial statements. So we already have sort of three layers of peer review that exists. And on top of that, every couple of years, we hire independent firms to try to replicate their work. So last year, we hired two firms, Chiron, who was selected to audit, to review the experience study, which you saw their report in February, and also the valuations for the cash balance, the defined benefit supplement, and the SBMA and the Medicare Premium Program, which they did. And Siegel Consulting was hired to review the defined benefit valuation, which is in front of you. They were also asked to review the GASB work that Milliman did for us last year. They are still working on this, and we expect them to complete their report over the next 2 months. And we'll be bringing it to you once it's completed. Basically, both companies have found that the calculations done by Milliman met all actuarial standards of practice, and they were able to replicate the results within a reasonable range. So some of them provided some improvements or ideas over how we could do things differently in the future. So we intend to have a discussion with Milliman starting in the near future, now that the evaluation is done, to see how we could incorporate some of these suggestions in the future. But with that, we do have representatives from both Siegel Consulting and Chiron in the audience in case you had any questions for them about the work they did. And if you have any questions for us, we're happy to answer. And again, this is an information item. You don't have to vote on anything.
I just more had a process question. Is there, so we hired Chiron and Siegel. Is it just expertise and scope of practice that we hired two different firms to do two different things? Or is that standard practice to hire two? I'm just kind of curious why that decision.
So it is actually not the usual practice among retirement systems to hire two separate firms. Usually one firm is hired to do various reviews of the actuary's work.
Because it's like a second pair of eyes, right?
So yes, this is actually because some of the work they do as far as, you know, just making sure assumptions are reasonable are actually the same. So we hire them for separate tasks, but not everything is completely separate. But so, yes, we hired two firms. One reason is they both can be working on the project simultaneously. So
different
there's
parts of the project.
Yes, parts of it. And so they both could be done. One advantage is actually as Milliman was doing the experience study, Chiron was doing their review and their replication. So we made sure that when Milliman got through, Chiron had done the review, and so the results that we presented to you were actually, had already actually been reviewed, which is also unusual in the profession. Usually you wait and just get the finished product, and after it's been presented, and then you look at it.
I think I was just more wondering though, like Siegel could have done that. I guess I'm more asking.
Yes,
like,
they both could have done.
You had two different firms
As a matter of fact.
I'm just trying to understand the world of actuaries and how all this stuff works.
So in 2011, we had very close to what we've done now. We had Milliman reviewed. Actually, Chiron did the work that Siegel's doing, and Siegel did a lot of the work that Chiron's doing. So they switched. So both of them have done sort of both sides of the equation for us.
So it's just, okay. So it's volume? Is that, I'm just...
There's volume, and then there is, because actual firms are can be very different, and they can look at things very differently.
Okay.
So, and they have different standards. So it does make a difference what actuaries...
So even the idea of switching those two companies to do the two different functions actually gives us a different angle.
Yeah, just
on
a little bit different. So, okay. And we don't, okay. And we'll look at it again in the future to see if one is probably better. But so, it's not something that's set in stone.
Thank you. So, we talked when we looked at the DB actuarial report a few minutes ago. Few hours ago, whenever it was, that that we were that there's the risk report in November, and then there's the actuarial report, and that a lot of the risk discussion would go into the risk report. I do note though that both firms, both Chiron and Siegel, one of the main things they do note is they think that the reports, the actuarial reports, in one case on DBS and cash balance, and on the other case on DB. Don't show as much discussion of risk as they would like to see.
Yes.
And so I'm wondering, is it appropriate to then take that discussion out of the actuarial report and put it into a separate risk report, or really does it need to be in the actuarial report? One of them, I think, Chiron referenced some actuarial standards. So I'm just trying to understand whether we really should be having this in the actuarial report.
Okay, so maybe Dave can weigh in on this too. So I think this is one area. So actuarial standards of practice do not require that they be in the a robust discussion in the actuarial report. What the actual standards board is looking at, and so they're actually putting together a standard on risk even as we speak. Where we're going and what we will be required to look at is actually get that information to you. So in a report. It doesn't necessarily have to be in Nick's report, but we would still want it in a report and with plenty of time to discuss it. So what we really want to do is to have a lot of time to discuss it versus today where we've spent a lot of time on the valuation report and maybe people are not prepared as much to discuss the risks surrounding it. So yes, I think Chiron's comments are valid. We plan to do address those in a companion report, which is you can think of it actually as valuation two, if you want to think of it in those terms. So yes, so you're actually right. We do need to discuss that, and we need to have a more robust discussion of that, and so a longer discussion.
And so that will those comments will be addressed by what's in the.
Yes.
In the risk report. And I guess then my only other question, and this is my lack of understanding of sort of the role of internal actuary versus our external actuary. The November report is really your report, the two of you.
Yes.
As opposed to Milliman's.
It is.
So
but
is there some value or importance to having Milliman, our external actuary, talk to us about risk?
I'll let Nick jump in if he wants to as well, but I just want to let you know that the whole process we had last year, we did not come up with it on ourselves, Rick and I. We had several discussions with Mark and Nick at Milliman, and we also, for validation purposes, we asked them to run their own independent analysis. We ran ours to make sure we came up to the same result as a way to validate each other's calculations. So although Rick and I presented it, they had input into the process as well.
And we'll continue, so.
Yeah, I mean, we could discuss that. I mean, possibly we could co-author the report or.
I don't know. I mean, yeah. I don't know whether there's value to us in,
As Rick
in
said,
having that. That's.
As
I mean,
Rick
we have
said,
a lot of external experts who are not staff who kind of attest to the board on all sorts of things. And so I'm just asking the question whether, when we talk about actuarial risk, whether that should come from an independent actuary. Or whether it's sufficient to come internally, I don't know the answer to that. I look to you. You're the actuary to the board, right?
As Rick said, I mean, there isn't a risk actual standards. There isn't an actual standards of practice dealing with risk right now. There is a proposed one. So at that point, then we'd have to review to see if what our current approach is, if we continue with this current approach, or whatever our new approach is. Satisfies that. But right now, we're just trying to do common sense. And as Dave said, we were involved in the process. So I think from a practical standpoint, I think we met that. But I think it's something we'll continue to look at.
So you would tell the board if you thought there was something misleading in their risk report.
Oh yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
He tell us.
All right, that concludes the speaking list. Go ahead, Sharon.
I'm sorry.
No, you're good.
Just because we've been talking about this so many times, and it's starting to so the risk report that we keep referring to, that happened. We get that every year, correct?
We did that for the first time last November.
Okay.
That was the first time ever.
Last year was the first time.
And our plan is to do it every single year in the future.
So every November, at least at this point, until we change it, every November, starting last year, so this next November upcoming will be our second time, and it'll be part of your report from the actuaries to talk to us about risk.
Yes.
Right? Okay.
Yes.
Just wanted to, because we've been talking about risk in a lot of different places, so I just wanted to make sure I kind of planted a flag on. And I'm looking forward to the conversation, so thanks.
And again, we'll be looking at mostly funding risk toward the funding of our system.
Great.
All righty.
That's one of our enterprise risks.
There you go.
So,
all right, Robin, it's to you.
So my comments are really related to both this item and the next item on the legislation activities. In a budget hearing, not last week, but the week before, we had a question relative to the funding of the DB plan from the Senate subcommittee that was hearing our budget request. And so I just wanted to alert the board to the fact that they had made a request of us to model what would happen if there was a capital infusion into the DB program and the outcomes related to contribution rates as a result of that capital infusion. Subsequent to the hearing, we got specific requests to model an infusion of $250 million, $500 million, and $1 billion as of January 17. And so we've done that modeling. And I just, again, wanted to advise you of the fact that the question had come forward subsequently today. I've gotten some follow-up questions about what the impact would be on the employer contribution rate and whether we thought this would apply to the state contribution rate. I think in conversations with David, and correct me because I didn't have this written down, the impact on the employer contribution rate would be fairly de minimis.
Correct.
And that I also shared back with the Department of Finance representative that we're working with on this, that what I took away from the questioning that I received at the subcommittee hearing was that this would be a curtailment of principle in terms of the unfunded actuarial obligation and not have an impact on current contribution rates from either the state or the employer community. So again, I just wanted you to know that we had gotten that question and that we're in the process of working with finance to answer it.
Thank you. Appreciate that. All righty, anything else for our crew up front? All righty, let's take a 10-minute break. We come back at a quarter till.